The peso's range is at 58 to 58.50 right now. The lowest early last quarter of 2023 of 59.20. Now a striking distance, really, and that's scary. Now, what were the circumstances that propelled last year's weakness and how did we overcome it?
Yeah. Now, if you remember last year, that was also pretty quick. Eh? It deteriorated very quickly, but eventually it strengthened also. No? So I guess we just have that seasonal effects. No? And then, of course, when the government also, you know, explained their policy, that there was continued growth anyway, that showed support for the country in terms of the foreign investments. All the trips, even if the, you know, they're numerous, but they've been, you know, I think they have their fruits to that. There, we have talked to a lot of investors. We have to see more of the signing, but I think that's partly also because we're, the government is addressing the ease of doing business. They have these green corridors, which we appreciate. So as long as there are more of these investments that will happen, and then we see a lot of the infrastructure happening, I'm hopeful with that, and then therefore at least the peso will strengthen in hopefully in the next few weeks, and then back to normal.
Okay, and now a couple of stories before this interview. We had an economic briefing with the economic managers. We had Finance Secretary Ralph Rektor's explanation on why they recalibrated growth targets from the 6.5 to 7.5 range now at 6 to 7 range. Given that recalibration, do you think it is more realistic as well that we can at least achieve the lower end of that range by the end of this year?
We're very hopeful, Stanley. No, of course, even the sixth range, the lower end is challenging because of, inflation really and hitting some of our commodity prices. Mm. But I believe it's doable anyway. Sorry, there should be the momentum. If loan growth is an indication of pent-up demand, we're seeing loan growth across all sectors, which is key. Not just corporate, but even the consumer and even the cars. As you know, the car sales are fantastic. So that shows that they're building up. They're doing CapEx again. It's not just maintenance, and then they're stocking up of inventory. And of course, there's a lead time for that. So we're very hopeful because we're seeing that across the industry standard.
All right, loan growth is in fact challenged. And this morning we had a conversation with EEI about its upcoming collaboration with CIC on the Cavite Calax enhancements, which EEI is taking part in. Its president, Mr. Henry Antonio, shared that the property and construction sector's tough pandemic years and a double whammy, in fact, with high borrowing rates immediately thereafter. It is persisting until now. Another threat is the peso weakness, which could also influence a lot of decisions when it comes to the construction industry. Now, how bumpy are you seeing the next couple of months for this sector?
Yeah, the construction is really a challenging industry because I've also had conversations with George Consunji, right, the president of DMCI Construction. You can have really lots of swings there. So you ideally, as a construction company, you should not even take risks in terms of pricing of the steel and the cement and everything. That should really be the customer, right? So I agree with Henry's point about, you know, these things can cause big changes in the budgeting. Yeah. But hopefully they have built in also these escalation clauses or change orders with their clients. But yes, it's really going to be bumpy, but bumpy also is good, pardon the pun, because if it's bumpy, that means there's construction and there's roads and bridges and airports to be built, Stanley.
All right, let's talk about the stock market now, Ed. We are back in the 6,500 level amid lackluster trading sentiment. Anything in the horizon you're seeing that's favorable or even inspiring for investors to hold on to this market?
It's still particularly been it's really mood sentiment, eh? Because diba, I'm a firm believer in talking to even other great analysts like April Litan, you know, it's undervalued. You just really have to invest, you know, be convict and hold your conviction, because I believe in the next year, at least by September, October, when rates go down, the market will really hit high. So it's just a question of timing it. But then there are still great investments now. Even a real estate investment trust, when you look at the current yields, they're already yielding around 7% net. So that's very good with the current pricing. So that's a conservative play. And then of course, PLDT, Globe will continue to have good dividend policies. And of course, I was very happy that China Gold has gone up significantly, and that will also announce a very good dividend soon. So at least there are good dividend stocks still to buy if you're a little afraid. And then, of course, the Konglos and the banks are continue to do well while rates are elevated, especially.
Yeah, a lot of the analysts we've spoken to are divided on whether this rally is continuing or it is plateauing or on a downward trend even. But there are developments that could, push that argument as to this market still being an uptrend market following the BSP's less hawkish stance, of course, in its latest meeting. Bond rates now dipping sharply. You have from 7.03 at least to 6.62. I don't know if this is any indication, Ed, that investors now have appetite or a shifting, in fact, to equities and risky assets. What conditions must be there to see a shift to stocks from the safe havens of last year?
Okay. Now, Stanley, you had a very good point. The fact that the benchmark rates are already going down, or even among the interbank, it's already going down because they're already expecting a pricing in the price cut, the rate cut. So that really means that appetite for fixed income will improve. And that's why, in a way, sometimes, of course, there's still net sales, but I guess net sale of foreign, but there's already a lot of people of interest coming in, lots of road shows that's happening. And that's why some of the banks have announced also dollar deals. We're seeing that sentiment there. They're ready to invest. And then I guess the fact that we've successfully had one IPO, China Gold, and then we're doing C-REC. It really shows you, compared to last year, but these are two relatively large deals, almost something like 12 billion, 5, 6 billion pesos each, 12 billion. That's a good sign. Parang that means the market is better because even I have to deal with the foreign and local investors. They're braving it again. So admittedly, not yet in, not a big herd, but their investors already listening, and then they're shifting their assets out of fixed income into equity. So for me, the two IPOs are a good sign, and I think there's a third IPO.
Yeah, by July, next gen, I think. I think it's next gen.
Correct, next gen, right?
Next gen, right. That's for July.
Sister bank, but that's great. So three IPOs in the last few weeks is a very good sign, Sam. So that's a sign that things are getting better, and then rates are going down. So we just need the BSP to signal the rate cut, even just one cut lang. I'll be extremely happy.
Hope to touch base again with you and the C-REC launches by June 7, Ed, to see how appetite really is for initial public offerings. Again, thank you so much for those insights, Mr. Ed Francisco, President of BDO Capital. Have a great trading week ahead.
Thank you, Stanley. Take care. Bye-bye.